church. We waited for this day. We gathered in your name, calling out to you. Good standing, awakening desire to burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heaven, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. Glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. See you, open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and feeling every part of our praise. Sing, open up the heaven, open up the heaven. We want to see you, open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. Feeling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. That's our prayer today. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Oh, open up the heaven. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. And feeling every part of our praise. Open up the heaven, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. And feeling every part of our praise. Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome. So glad you're here. You can have a seat this morning. Yeah, it's good to see you guys. It's good to see you online somewhere. I can see you. I really can. But it's good to see you. Welcome. If you're visiting, we welcome you. If you can see in front of their pew right there, there's a welcome card. Feel free to fill that out and put it in the old offering on the way out tonight or to this morning. That's not tonight, this morning. If you're visiting online, feel free to shoot us a comment and just let us know you're there. A couple things I want to bring to your attention this morning. Let's see, family night, Saturday, August 15th, 6 to 8 p.m. There's going to be a dunk tank, some games. I am going to nominate Matt to be in the dunk tank. Unless anybody wants to volunteer. But I think Matt would be a great, right? Okay. Matt, if you're watching, I still love you. So. Then invite your friends there, families, your kids, whatever. It's going to be a great night. I think we'll have a good evening. Also, the church family picnic is August 28th. Yeah, we're going to have one service at 10:45, and then we're going to jump out to the backyard here and have a good old picnic. Bring your lawn chairs, or else you're going to be standing. but we'll have a good time as a family once again. Hopefully everybody can make it be good. So, but we're here to worship, amen. We're here to glorify the God. We're here to exalt him. We're here to give everything that we are through our voices, through our hearts. We're declaring his great and his awesome power. So would you stand? Let's start our time of worship this morning.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you, yeah. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, yeah. Darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you, yeah. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Stronger, God, you are higher than it.
we go. Here we go.
You're calling me over. You're pulling me close. We love you, surround me. You give me hope. Oh, yeah. You're taking me deeper. You're making me whole. With grace, you redeem me. Yeah. You restore my because of you. You hold my head up. You remind me who I am. You hold my head up. I'm alive in you again. I'm made new. Oh, I'm made new. Oh, you're making me stronger. Healing my heart. Give your hand to hold me in. Set me apart. Now I'm made new because of you. Hold my head up. Remind me who I am. Hold my
sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a beautiful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, veil torn before you. Silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, praise of your glory. You are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. You have no right. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, complete adoration of you. Lord, we are just grateful for a moment to just lift you up in praise and song. Lord, I'm grateful for that you are here with us this moment, and that your spirit would just move among us in a mighty way. And that our hearts would just be open to hear your word this morning. Would change us and move us in a mighty way. Lord, I always pray, Father, that you would just have us leave this place, leave our homes in a new way, that we leave, that we live all on for you. Lord, how beautiful you are, how wonderful you are. Lord, we just can't forget how powerful you are. Show us your power this morning. Lord, we are so grateful for this time. I pray these things in your name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. Good to greet you this morning, and if you have your Bibles with you, why, you can turn to Mark. I was reading Acts last night at our Saturday night service, and now I need to switch and remember that I'm in Mark here this morning. But Mark chapter 14, beginning at verse 35. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, elders, and teachers of the law came together. Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days I will build another not made by man. Yet even then their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One? I am, said Jesus, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. The high priest tore his clothes. Why do we need any more witnesses, he asked. You've heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They all condemned him to be worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, Prophesy. And the guards took him and beat him. For those of you who've ever watched any court proceedings in federal court or listened to the audio presentations before the Supreme Court, you know that there's a certain decorum and a solemnity that is preserved in the courtroom. The spectators are warned in advance that there's to be no outbursts, no applause, and from the moment the bailiff announces the entrance of the judge or the justices with the customary all rise, to the sounding of the gavel and the words, the court is adjourned, there is to be silence in the court, except for the attorneys and the judges. With a little bit of a different twist on that theme of silence in the court, we see that Jesus appeared before the Jewish court known as the Sanhedrin. And we read that in verses 60 and 61, then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, Are you going to answer? What is this testimony these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. As I spoke with Pastor Hill and asked him, Does he have any specific passage he would like me to preach on? He said, you can either choose your own subject matter, or he said, I was planning on preaching on Mark chapter 14, the trial of Jesus. And so I considered that and said, I guess I'll keep that study of the Gospel of Mark going. And so I'm sure that in weeks past, Pastor Hill shared with you the fierce internal struggle that Jesus faced there in Gethsemane as he struggled to be obedient to death, even to death on a cross. The events of Gethsemane culminated with that despicable act of betrayal by Judas with a kiss, a prearranged signal that Judas would use to identify Jesus to the Jewish officials. And then in verse 50 of Mark 14, we read, Then everyone deserted him and fled. And though the scriptures don't tell us this, we can assume that from that point on, things got rather quiet as this band of renegades marched Jesus to the residence of the high priest. And since this was an illegal operation by the religious officials, they would have wanted the whole scenario to be carried out very quickly and very quietly. And through the streets of Jerusalem, they moved silently as Jesus walked, bound by the guards alongside of him. As later, so now, he says nothing. And they come to the high priest's residence, and they climb the stairs to the high priest's quarters, and they enter this room that was probably dimly lighted with flickering candlelight. And the trial begins. To fully understand this and the other trials that Jesus was subjected to, it's helpful for us to understand that in the hours preceding the crucifixion, Jesus was brought to face judgment in six different courts of law, before six different judges. As you study the gospel accounts and you look at the synoptic gospels plus the gospel of John, you find that there are six different trials that are summarized and combined. And here in Mark chapter 14, the first three of those trials is noted in the passage that I read a little while ago. So trial number one, according to John's gospel, was before Annas, the high priest. Annas questions Jesus as he's brought before him, and Annas acted as a prosecuting attorney as well as the judge. And I suspect that Annas would probably tell us, well, I was just having an informal discussion here with Jesus. I was not bound by the official rules of the courtroom proceedings, even though Jesus was bound as he was brought before Annas. We're told that Annas asked Jesus all kinds of questions about his teaching and about his disciples. And in Jesus' testimony, rather than answering Annas, he points out, he says, listen, my teachings, my beliefs are very common knowledge. They're very clearly known. And you really do know what I believe. And so that response was unacceptable to the court officials. And we read they struck him in the face. Annas, perhaps because he was an older man and had some wisdom, or because of the potential that he feared for the backlash against him if he in any way incriminated Jesus, said, I'm going to turn the proceedings over to my son-in-law, Caiaphas, who seemed to be the one that might have been the mastermind behind the whole betrayal and the arrest in the first place. And so that leads us to trial number two. First of all, before Annas, now before Caiaphas. And it's this trial that Mark most fully represents in the scripture reading that we had here this morning. Caiaphas was a member of the Sanhedrin, and therefore he wanted to bring some other people alongside of him. And so trial number three then was before the Sanhedrin. Now the Sanhedrin was the Jewish legal body comprised of 70 men plus the high priest. And he served as kind of the tiebreaker there, so that if the 70 came out 35-35, he would break the tie. We might say that the Sanhedrin was somewhat akin to, say, our Supreme Court. This court was the council of final appeals. If you thought you were unfairly treated by any of the lower courts, you would bring them up before the Sanhedrin that met there in Jerusalem. And since Israel was occupied by the Romans, the Sanhedrin dealt primarily with issues related to religious law, while the Roman court system dealt with matters related to the legal system itself. And for such a trial to occur, you need to understand that there needed to be at least 23 members of the Sanhedrin gathered together to form a quorum. And so these first three trials all took place within the Jewish court system. And while they could have convicted Jesus of a crime, they were powerless to carry out any kind of execution, because that would have had to be carried out by the Roman government, the Roman authorities. And so they realized that while they could accuse Jesus, while they could indeed trump up some charges against him, they were powerless to do anything with those charges. And so that leads to trial number four, where Jesus is then sent to Pilate, the Roman governor of Judea. Pilate tried to avoid this sticky situation. He really didn't want to get involved. And so what he did is he passed Jesus on to a higher Roman authority, Herod the king, who happened to be in Jerusalem during that period of time for the Passover observance. And Herod's jurisdiction included the very birthplace of Jesus, Galilee. And Pilate thought, you know, I can just say, listen, this is your man. He came out of your community, out of your town, so you take over at this point. So trial number five then was the trial before Herod. But Herod was smart, and he was not going to get tangled up in this Jewish legal debacle. And so he sends Jesus back to Pilate, which was the last trial then that Jesus faced. And all this happened within a matter of a few hours. So trial number six was before Pilate again, and he finally succumbed to the pressure of the Jewish authorities and reluctantly ordered the execution of Jesus. With that background of information before us, Mark focuses primarily on trial number three and trial number six, the courts of last resort for both the Jewish religious community as well as the Roman legal system. And our focus this morning now is going to be primarily on what happened as Jesus was brought before the Sanhedrin. Throughout this trial, there were all kinds of illegalities. As the temple guards escorted Jesus to the high priest's quarters, the trial begins immediately, and it was made up of one injustice after another injustice. First, according to Jewish law, it was illegal for a prisoner to be brought bound in front of the Sanhedrin unless he was already condemned or he was offering resistance. But we know that was not the case with Jesus, because as Judas betrayed him there in the garden, he didn't put up a fight. And so what we see here is that it was illegal right from the very beginning. Secondly, it was held at night, and Jewish law forbade that any legal transactions could happen during the night. All trials were to be before the priests during the daytime. But this trial was taking place in the middle of the night. Scholars believe it was probably about 11 o'clock when Judas betrayed Jesus there in the garden. And so then Jesus was arrested there and appeared before Annas and then Caiaphas, and now the Sanhedrin. So it had to be in the wee hours of the early morning. Thirdly, this trial was not happening at the right place. You see, the Sanhedrin met in a hall that was set aside for just their trials, similar to our Supreme Court building in Washington, D.C., where when the Supreme Court is in session, it meets, it deliberates there in that building. But here they were meeting in the home of the high priest. Fourthly, the Sanhedrin by law was prohibited from handing down a verdict other than an acquittal on the same day as the trial. If a guilty verdict was to be handed down, it had to be issued the next day or a subsequent day. But here, the verdict was passed down immediately at the end of this farcical trial. And fifth, it was illegal to conduct a trial on a feast day. But this trial was held on the highest of holy days in the Jewish calendar, on the day of Passover. And we see then that this trial was illegal and unfair right from the very beginning. And furthermore, what they did, it's middle of the night, they rouse other people to serve as witnesses and, who knows, pay them off to bear false testimony against Jesus. We know that to be true from what we see in verses 56 and following. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, "I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days I will build another, not made by man." Yet even then their testimony did not agree. Now that alone should have been sufficient evidence to just simply throw out the case, because clearly Jewish law had no time for false witnesses in the courtroom. Bearing false witness was a serious crime and punishable with the same penalty that the accused would have received. In fact, the law of God for the Jews was very clear, as we see in Deuteronomy chapter 19, 16 to 19. If a malicious witness takes the stand to accuse a man of a crime, the two men involved in the dispute must stand in the presence of the Lord before the priests and judges who are in the office at that time. The judges must make a thorough investigation And if the witness proves to be a liar giving false testimony against his brother, then do to him as he intended to do to his brother. You must purge this evil from among you. Now, ancient legend offers a reason for the discrepancy among the witnesses. They said that they went out and they tried to get some people that knew about Jesus and to get them to testify against him. They were kind of making it up as they went along. But tradition says that as they began to testify, not only were there those that were making, you know, false accusations about Jesus, but there were those who said, "Well, now I was a leper and Jesus cleansed me. I was blind and he gave me my sight back. I was lame and I became able to walk again." Now, these were the best witnesses that money could buy. And yet everything was falling apart, and the priests were getting uneasy and restless because the testimony of these people did not agree. But then a number of men stood up and they gave this testimony. They said, "He threatened to destroy this man-made temple. I heard him say it with my own ears." Well, it was kind of a weak charge, but it was something. And quoting what Jesus said, almost, thought they could maybe get something out of that. Because Jesus really didn't say that I'm going to destroy this man-made temple. He said, "Destroy this temple," meaning his body, "and in 3 days I will raise it up again." Well, with that charge that he was going to tear down the temple, that was enough. Put him over the top. And so at that point, the high priest dismisses the witnesses, and he takes the floor himself. And at that point, the high priest saved the occasion from the Sanhedrin's point of view by doing another thing that was entirely illegal. He attempted to put Jesus on the spot and force him to incriminate himself, as we read in verses 60 and 61. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. The silence of Jesus, I'm sure, threw Caiaphas into a fit of frustration. And he says, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One? Answer me." To which Jesus responds in verse 62, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on clouds in the sky, in heaven." Perhaps for an instant, Caiaphas kind of freezes in time, stunned by this admission of Jesus. And then his rage seems to boil to the top. And the scripture says in verse 63 that he tore his clothes. He said, "Why do we need any more witnesses? You heard it. This man is guilty of blasphemy. What do you think?" And they all condemned him as worthy of death. The matter before the council all came down to one thing: the charge of blasphemy. Let's face it, this entire proceeding was a travesty of justice, and yet out of this travesty emerges a powerful truth to the identity and the claim of Jesus. You see, there are many critics and liberal scholars who will assert that at no time did Jesus ever say that he was the Son of God, that he was the Messiah. They'll tell you those are claims that were brought about by his disciples. And if you ever hear anybody trying to give you that argument, you point them to this passage of Scripture. There are other places where Jesus very clearly said that he was the promised one, the Messiah, but none clearer than here. Because you see, he was on the witness stand and he had solemnly pledged to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And when he was asked that question, he simply and clearly states, "I am the Messiah. I am the Son of God. No doubt about it." And then they did something to Jesus once again that was totally illegal. For we read in verse 65, "Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him. They struck him with their fists, and they said, "Prophesy." And the guards took him and beat him. Now, the Apostle Peter had seen all of this from a distance, and he never forgot it. In fact, in his first letter, he writes that we're to remember that scene and to take heed of it, to allow Christ to serve as an example for us. For we read there in 1 Peter 2:23, "When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats." Now, the question certainly that begs to be answered here is, why was Jesus silent? Why didn't he defend himself against these trumped-up charges? Well, he was fulfilling a mission that he came to carry out into the world. And his silence, of course, was a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy that we read in Isaiah 53:7. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. You see, Jesus had endured a war of the wills, if you will, in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he prayed, "Father, if at all possible, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I want, what I will, but what you want." And so Jesus offered no resistance here, no defense, because he knew that he was committed at that point in the Garden of Gethsemane to carrying out this mission of redemption. So clearly, he claimed to be the Son of God. Let's face it, he can't be the Son of God and not be the Son of God at the same time. One is true, one is a liar. And if Jesus is a liar, then he was a colossal liar. And we would be foolish to trust him for anything, much less our eternal life. So few would label Jesus as a liar. You see, most people would say he was a good man, he was a great teacher, he was a great role model, but he couldn't be any of that if he was a colossal liar. And then there are those that would argue, well, no, he didn't intentionally lie, but he was just mistaken. He was deluded. And if Jesus indeed was deluded, some kind of a psychotic lunatic that was claiming some kind of spiritual power and authority that was not him, then it would be very foolish of anybody to place any trust in anything that this man would have said. So we need to be honest here. If Jesus was a liar or a lunatic, we just can write him off. But if he is who he claimed he said he is, that he is the Son of God, the Savior of the world, then we would be foolish to ignore those claims and those demands upon our life. And so this morning I would invite you to examine this evidence. And if you've not already done so, to make up your mind about who Jesus really is. You really only have three choices as you look at Jesus, as Josh McDowell has noted so well in his book, More Than a Carpenter. Your choices are three. Either Jesus was a liar, or he was a lunatic, or he is the Lord. You see, over 2,000 years have gone now, and people have questioned Jesus' testimony and integrity without success. More than anyone else who has ever lived, Jesus has proven to be a model of truthfulness, of honesty, of integrity, and his message has withstood the tests of time. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And that claim has stood for over 2,000 years. It has stood the test of time. The Bible, his book, has been translated into more languages than any other book in the entire world. The Jesus movie has been seen by more people than any other movie in the world. And his church has survived for over 200 millennia, despite internal divisions, despite the times where the church has lost its vision and purpose, and despite the fact that there are times have been public scandals in the church. And all of this is a testimony to the veracity of Jesus' claim that he is indeed the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And those who would argue against that, those who are his detractors, the burden of proof really is upon them. You see, more than the miscarriage of justice that Mark chronicles for us here in chapter 14, what we need to see in this scene is the hand of God reaching out to us, to you, to me, providing us with a means of salvation and hope as Jesus, the sinless Son of God, dies in our place for our sin. And so the real issue before us is quite simple. Will you take the hand that has been extended to you by our Heavenly Father and receive so great salvation, or will you turn away? You see, the decision is yours, and it's yours alone to make. And when all is said and done, you either stand with the Savior or you stand with his accusers. There's no middle ground. In a very real sense, it's not Jesus that really is on trial here. It is you. It is me. Was Jesus who he said he was? We certainly have lots of evidence, and that evidence demands a verdict. That evidence calls for a decision. And so my question to you this morning is, what is your decision? There's an old gospel song that raises that profound question, and I share those words with you in closing, the lyrics of which are like this. Jesus is standing on trial still. You can be false to him if you will. You can be faithful through good or ill. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. Someday your heart will be asking, what will you do with me? And so I ask you that question this morning. What will you do with Jesus? What have you done with Jesus? Will you pray with me? Perhaps as you listened here this morning, it became abundantly clear that you need to get off the fence because there is no middle ground here. Either you are with Jesus and for Jesus, or you're against him. And perhaps you realize this very clear evidence that the Bible gives to us, the historical record of our Savior, is such that you need to come to terms with his offer of salvation. And if that's how the Spirit of God is moving in your heart this morning, I would simply ask you to pray along with me, to silently offer this prayer. Dear God, I admit that I am a sinner, and I need your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ died in my place, paying the penalty for my sins. And I'm willing right now to turn from my sin and accept Jesus as my personal Savior and Lord. I commit myself to you, and I ask you through your Holy Spirit to fill me and take control of me in such a way that I will become the kind of person you want me to be. Thank you, Father, for loving me. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that we have such a wonderful Savior. Lord, it is a beautiful name. It is a wonderful name. It is a powerful name that provides our salvation. And Father, we thank you for the assurance that we can have that when we open our hearts to Jesus as Savior and Lord, not only does he transform us and change us from the inside out, but he promises us the gift of eternal life. And so, Lord, while Jesus was silent in the court, we want to lift up our voices and shout from the housetops that Jesus is Savior and Lord, and we want to acknowledge him in all ways as Lord and Savior. Lord, help us to do that, even in a time of difficulty and challenge that we're living in, to never lose our focus, that our lives have been redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, and that in the end, if we are with him, we will be victorious, now and forevermore. Amen.
Not a wonder, still inside, heaven's brilliance from above. A light of glory pierced the darkness. Mercy pierced my heart with love. This is Jesus, King of glory, here to rescue from the foe. Son of God who comes to save us, Prince of peace and Lord of all. Oh, the mystery, who could fathom? God would leave his holy throne for a manger, for a sinner, for us all to be his own. This is Jesus, King of glory, here to rescue from the foe. Son of God who comes to save us, Prince of peace and Lord of all. Rejoice, hope is here. Rejoice, he is with us. Rejoice, hope is here. Rejoice, he is with us. Rejoice, hope is here. Rejoice, he is with us. Rejoice. To rescue from the foe, Son of God who comes to save us, Prince of peace and Lord of all. For our hearts so prone to wander, for these feet so quick to flee, God is here and love is reaching for the lost and least of these.
If you prayed that prayer that I had asked you to pray, and you made a decision for Jesus Christ and said, I'm going to stand with Jesus, I'd love to chat with you, and just come and see me after the service and just share with you some scriptures and encourage you in that new walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. And now may the grace of God, the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. I'm going to ask you be seated, and the ushers will then dismiss you. And I'm going to kind of head out toward the lobby area, and if you want to talk to me afterward, you can. That's good. button.